talks about not just responding to demand as it is expressed via purchasing decisions, but also kind of predicting demand or predicting consumer desires before they manifest themselves in purchases. Like, without giving us away all your secrets, how does one go about doing that?
Yeah, so I think there's a few things in play here. I think, so if you pull data in from the retail level or the wholesale level, so the buyer level of the food industry, you can start to see what patterns are arising regionally. So what are people buying? What are they leaning towards? Now that can be skewed data completely. It can be what was actually offered in a market. So, you know, if I only offer kale as an option for lettuces, then 100% of my sales are gonna be kale, and you're just gonna see this uptick in kale, right? So you have to think about this data skew, which is really an interesting problem to solve for. Then if you break it down and look at consumer level data, and what are people demanding? So people are demanding local, they are demanding fresher, they are demanding sort of different taste profiles for different crops. So tomatoes is the example I gave. Usually people are looking for their grandmother's tomato, the tomato that was grown in their backyard as a kid, not the sort of cardboard tasting, low sugar content tomato. But that's quantifiable. It's quantifiably a Brix content related issue, sugar content in tomatoes, and freshness. So you can start to understand consumer trends, you can start to understand retail and wholesale trends, and then if you could match that up to what a grower can actually grow, and grow right, then you can have this really interesting pushback of consumer demand and predicting consumer demand against what growers can actually grow. And one of the things that's nice about indoor, which is what we deal with, the indoor ag space, is that most growers can tailor the crops slightly. And you'll approach a greenhouse grower for something very different than you would approach a field grower for. You won't look for corn in indoor. You won't look for corn, wheat, soy, any of the cereals or grains. What you're going to be looking for is highly perishable, short growth cycle, fresh produce, berries, vine crops, lettuces, herbs, those types of things.
And so, thinking about the one's grandmother's tomatoes, and for the purposes of our audience, you know, who aren't in ag or aren't familiar that much with farming but are interested in technology, how might I use data from your system to influence the actual decisions that I would make as a farmer or a farmer working with indoor farming? How would I actually use the information?
Yeah, so our system manages everything from seed to harvest in a facility. So everything that would affect the plant while it's growing is managed within our system. That's everything from your crop management. So what are you growing? Where is it going? How is it moving from stage to stage of growth, to labor? Who's touching it? Who's doing that? What is everybody doing in the facility? To traceability, so actually keeping a record of where that crop is going from seed through retail, to compliance. Food safety compliance is a huge thing that we deal with, and keeping up with regulation on that front. So the fact that you trust the thing that you eat to not make you sick, that's, you know, a large part of something that we're dealing with. To things like climate management and lighting management are all things that we start to take a look at. Through to even things like pest management. So what kind of, how are you using good bugs to kill off bad bugs? Is the technical term for that. So we look at almost everything that would affect a plant while it's growing.
It's fascinating. There are a few trends that I've kind of picked up on during the conference, sort of conversations that a lot of people are having. And the customer desires and how generational changes will influence customer desires is a big one. Kevin Van Trump talked about this. You know, the millennial generation has very strong values, particular ideas about what they want, is willing to pay for it, and their purchasing power is increasing.
Yeah.
So how, sort of with that trend in mind, what are your thoughts or advice for people in this space?
Yeah, I think so. There's two probably separate things completely. Mm-hmm. First is, I think the most interesting thing that that's happening on the millennial trend, actually maybe three things. The most interesting to me thing to me on the millennial trends is how does that affect breeding in this space? So if you look at something like the baby carrot. It took years and years and years and years and years to breed the baby carrot. But it was bred because marketers essentially said, hey, there's a trend towards snacking in the US and we need to be on top of this. And so we're going to breed this carrot that's essentially uniformly cyclical as opposed or cylindrical as opposed to conical. And that way it's going to be easy to cut and it's going to be easy to process as a baby carrot that people can snack on. And it's like great. It's a great story, right? Everybody loves a baby carrot. But it was one of those times where the sort of market trend, coupled with marketers, coupled with buying, buying and who was buying, coupled with the actual production lined up. That doesn't always happen, and sometimes it's about marketers' stories steering something towards buyers. So I think one of the most interesting things is when you have this millennial group that is buying and buying differently, how that matches up to steering some of the breeding programs and what we're going to be producing years from now is a very interesting question. And so while we're not a breeding company, there are companies like Benson Hill or Indigo that are here and that have data that we as a company care about, because then we can watch how the crops are performing in a commercial setting and start to feed the consumer data back towards those companies and start to speed this loop up. So instead of a 10-year process for breeding, maybe you have a 5-year process and we can shrink the amount of time it takes to get interesting products to market. So I think that's interesting. I think the labor force is changing dramatically, and I think this is something that both companies like us as a tech company and farms themselves have to pay attention to. I think employing a millennial is very different than employing anybody that we've ever employed before. And it's for better or for worse, there's just different hiring habits and working habits. And I think as you think about labor being one of the biggest concerns facing farms today, there's just an interesting sort of paradigm shift happening with who's working and how work is being performed. And then similarly for us, for a tech company, how we engage with millennials and as a millennial, how we work with technology and how we are implementing technology at scale. It's just it's an interesting time for sure to see these generational shifts happening.
I bet. And final question. Being in the ag space, what has your experience been starting a business, and particularly with respect to capital and getting the flywheel going, as a lot of people have used that metaphor? What has your experience been?
So I started AgriList 3 years ago, and before that I was leading operations for a large greenhouse company, so I was directly in the space. And so I am a domain expert. I was a data scientist and operations head at, you know, somebody who's a customer of ours now. And started this company out of a direct pain point that I wanted to solve that was related to that, and understand the market probably better than most people in the space. So I think coming at it from that angle has definitely helped and alleviated some of the challenges that first-time entrepreneurs especially face in this in a fundraising climate. We have raised about $3 million so far of capital, and we have tremendous investors on our side. I think one of the interesting things is when we raised our first round a few years ago, the attitude of what are you doing was very common, right? So what are you doing? Who are you serving? What is this market really? How is ag going to be served by technology? Are farmers going to adopt technology? There was this sort of paradigm shift of or perspective shift of they thought farmers were guys with pitchforks and overalls standing in a bare, you know, on a bale of hay. Whereas in reality, if you walk on a farm, some of them are the most highly technical things you've seen. And I know there's a McKinsey study that's been passed around a lot in the industry about how non-digitized a lot of this industry is. But you do have technological advances, and you do have heavy machinery on these farms, and it is a pretty advanced operation. The key is in the actual how you deploy high tech now and deep tech towards advancing the industry forward. And so one of the things, you know, we are a software company, a data analytics play in a big market, and so I think it was easier for investors to get their heads around what we were doing.
I like it.